This is Chicho. Welcome to my channel and welcome to our second reading for this comic book reading set number 4. And for this reading set, for this comic book reading, what I did was picked another book from the 16 that I chose to read. And it's Donald in Math Magic Land. And this issue is the first printing of this comic. And it's Dell 4 Color 1051, and it came out on August 1st, 1959. And there's a second printing of this comic, and again, it's Dell 4 Color, but the issue number on it would be, for the second printing, was 1198. And you can check out the number there. Hopefully that's coming out. This is 1051. And I believe the 1198 also has a number up there, okay? And you can tell the difference between the printings because the first printing is 10 cents and the second printing that came out in 1961 is 15 cents, okay? Now, as far as the story in this issue is concerned, my exposure to Donald and Math Magic Land, I think most people's exposure to Donald and Math Magic Land came out in the animation that preceded this. And that one came out in June 26, 1959. And I probably saw that animation. I think the first time I saw that animation was in the 1980s. And it's about a half an hour animation, 27 minute animation that Walt Disney put out. And it was actually, the animation was actually nominated for an Academy Award for a short documentary. And when I was looking this information up regarding the animation, regarding the comic book, there's a quote that was credited to Walt Disney, and it's on the wiki page anyway for the animation. It states that Walt Disney said that the cartoon is a good medium to stimulate interest. We have recently explained mathematics in film, and in that way excited public interest in this very important subject, right? It's not a groundbreaking quote, but it shows us how far we have to go, or how far back it goes, where people are interested in education. And Walt Disney was, initially anyway, was interested in education. And everyone that was had a passion for this, for mathematics, was in a way trying to expose more people to the language of mathematics, right? And for the obvious reasons, for me anyway, the reason that I picked this comic book is because I am teaching mathematics, and the animation, when I first saw it, and I believe it was the 1980s where I first saw it, it really did blow me away. It was fantastic, and I think following that, when I saw it in 1980s when I was a kid, I didn't see it for a very long time until the 2000s really, when web 2.0 kicked into high gear and the streaming video was available online. I believe I saw it again on YouTube, okay? So that's sort of the background of this comic and where the story comes from. So let's crack this thing open and have a read through it. And from what when I flipped through this and from what I found online, this comic has a few one-pagers, a few shorts, and a 30-page story arc of Donald entering Math Magic Land, which is really adapted from the animation from 1959, right? And this is the cover, and it's this issue is sort of mid-lower grade. It's not bad. It's got some chipping on it, as you can tell here. Here, let me put it behind the white. You know, the corners aren't sharp. So it's sort of a mid-grade, I would assume, on this. It's not a low grade, but on the lower side, it's not a mid-high grade, I guess. And let's take a look at this. There isn't huge chunks missing from this. So if I was to grade this, I would give this one somewhere around a 4. And the edges are fairly sharp, right? There's no real chipping going on. So it's not a bad copy. Beautiful anime, beautiful, not animation, beautiful, beautiful artwork, yeah. And this is four color. It's the second, from what I understand, this is the second series that started in 1942. And we're hitting this with four color 1051 in 1959. Okay. Let's check this out. Mathematics and you. E equals mc squared, right? Einstein's relativity, I guess Einstein's equation on the electrodynamics of moving bodies. And we did sort of a video, I put together a video of Einstein's paper on basically relativity. And if you're interested in a little bit more discussion on E equals mc squared, on Einstein's basically groundbreaking paper on relativity, which entitled on the electrodynamics of moving bodies. We did talk a little bit about this, of why we can't travel at the speed of light, right? What are the other things they have here? Square root of 4 is equal to 2. That's half your answer. The true answer to this is the square root of 4 is equal to plus or minus 2, right? And we've done some videos on this as well for ASMR math, and that for the Einstein video as well. That's also ASMR math, and we've done a whole bunch of videos on radicals and exponents for language of mathematics as well. I'm really looking forward to flipping through this. While I flip through it, I'm really looking forward to reading this, right? So let's read this first page. And actually, let's be consistent with what we've been doing with all the other videos. Let's read the fine print for this. Walt Disney's, let's see if you can see that. Walt Disney, Donald and Math Magic Land number 1051, published by Dell Publishing Company, Inc., 750 3rd Avenue, New York, 17, New York, George T. Durham, publisher, junior publisher, Helen Meyer, president, Paul R. Lilly, executive vice president, Harold Clark, vice president of advertising, and all a bunch of names. It goes through all rights reserved throughout the world. Nothing herein contained to be reproduced without permission, Walt Disney Productions, authorized edition, printed in the U.S., designed and produced by Western Printing and Lithography Company, and that's basically Dell Publishing, that Western, adapted from the Walt Disney motion picture Donald and Math Magic Land, copyright 1959 by Walt Disney Productions, and that's the copyright for the animation. This periodical shall be sold only through authorized dealers. Sales of mutilated copies or copies without covers and distribution at this of this periodical for premiums, advertisings, or giveaways are strictly forbidden. And I believe the reason they put this in there, you can't sell this in mutilated form, because newsstands, when they were publishing comic books, for the issues that they didn't sell, they could have just removed the covers and sent back the covers to the publishers. So they weren't being allowed to sell the comic book without the covers, because they'd be sort of, I guess, lying to the publishers and pocketing the money that some of the money that the publishers were supposed to get. So let's take a read through this first page. Mathematics and you. Every time you swing to beat a dance orchestra or whistle a tune, you're acting out a mathematical equation. The principles of mathematics are applied in almost everything you do, make, use, and enjoy in your life today. And without this science, the world would be in a state of almost inconceivable confusion. For instance, could you describe yourself without the use of numbers? How could you tell anyone how tall you are or how old you are just for fun as you read the following? Supply your own figures to see how important numbers are to you. I am blank old. I was born blank. I am blank feet tall. I have blank head, eyes, blank eyes, blank ears, blank nose, blank mouth, blank arm, blank hands, blank legs, blank feet, blank fingers, and blank toes. I have blank sisters, blank brothers, blank uncles, blank aunts, blank cousins. I am in the blank grade, and I live in a house with blank rooms and a blank street. Simple way of exposing people to mathematics. Let's check out the last paragraph. Long centuries ago, Pythagoras, the Greek philosopher, observed everything is arranged according to number and mathematical shape. Hundreds of years later, Galileo, the great Italian physicist and astronomer, echoed the observations with mathematics is the alphabet in which God wrote the universe. And back in the day when I first started putting together math videos, I've had a lot of people ask me, why is math important, right? Sometimes in a condescending way, sometimes in a sort of general way, sometimes inquisitively, they really want to know why math is important, why they have to go through school, study mathematics for so long. So what I ended up doing is putting together two videos of why math was important. They're not ASMR math. One of them was sort of being pretty intense about it. And another one was sort of giving five or six reasons why math is important and why it has been important to me. And I 100% agree with this, but even more, for me, I can't even imagine my life without knowing mathematics. I wouldn't have been able to do many things without mathematics, right? So before we get started on this, let's figure out what's in this. I think this is the main storyline, Donald and Math Magic Land. Okay, so let's flip through this. And I believe this is supposed to be 30 pages. Cool. Okay, we're gonna definitely read this. This is the first story arc. The pages aren't numbered, but yeah. Now look at the center of this, it's pretty good. I believe it's got some rusting on the staples. Let's check it out. I guess so. I guess there's a little bit of rust on the staples, which is understandable. But they haven't, there's no staining due to the rust. Or it could be that just the staples are old. Yeah, I think so. Because sometimes we're in staple rust in comic books, they sort of stain the sides, right? Where it touches the paper and this one isn't. So this is in pretty good shape, actually. So this thing continues. Back. sort of like Pascal's triangle. Let's make the back as well. We'll flip this way in the book because it seems, it looks like the whole story arc is from the beginning, right? Math magic pyramid puzzle. This is sort of like Pascal's triangle, I guess. Let's check it out. Like the great pyramids of early Egypt, this pyramid is a puzzle to Donald and his nephews. Can you help them? What are they trying to do? What kind of game is this? Place small markers, such as a button or paper clips, on all letters except A. Now, by jumping, I'll bring this closer so we can read it together. Now, by jumping, try to remove all the markers except one, which in the last move must be left on the letter A. Small markers, such as buttons and paper clips. Okay. To do so, jump one marker over another to an empty spot and remove the marker that has been jumped over. Markers must be jumped along the lines only. For instance, you may jump marker E to A. E to A, where is E? E to A. So you can jump from there to there, jumping over the sky, but not E to I. Where is I? E. Oh yeah, because there's no line connecting this, right? So you can go along the lines, but you can't go this way, right? If you need to, turn the page upside down for the solution. Ah, these are the solutions, okay. So basically you put markers everywhere except on A and then you start doing the jumps. So if you jump from E to A, you would remove this one and you would have two empty spots. And then you could go from here to, from B to E. Oh no, you couldn't go from B to E. You would have to go start from here. Where would you go from here then? Oh yeah, you would have a marker here, but there's one wouldn't be empty, so how does that work? Place small markers, such as buttons or paper clips, on all letters, except A. Okay, now by jumping, try to remove all the markers, except one. Oh yeah, you would just go from C to E, that's right, and you would take off D. So that could be one move, or you could go from G to E and remove F, right? Okay. For sure, we should be able to figure this out. Nice little fun game. Fascinating fun with numbers. Let's check out the fascinating fun with numbers. The back cover. Donald Duck's double talk. I can prove that 7 goes into 28 13 times. That's funny. Reminds me of Abbott and Costello video as well. When they were trying to do mathematics. So Donald, I can prove that 7 goes into 28 13 times. Oh poo. Seven only goes into it 4 times. That's Huey, Dewey, and Louie, I believe, right? Let's check it out. That's so. First, I'll prove it by multiplication. Mm-hmm. 3 times 7 is 21, right? Right. And you'll admit 7 times 1 is 7. Well, of course. So there you are, 21 plus 7 is 28, which just goes to prove what I said. 7 goes into 28 13 times. Math and magic the wrong way. Of course, this is all just a confuser and not really accurate arithmetic, but you can make it sound almost right if you talk fast enough. Then prove it with the following addition. check out how he does it with addition. Here we have 7 thirteens. Now, I'll prove again that all this goes into 28. 7 threes add up to 21, and 7 ones add up to 7. 21 and 7 equals 28. This is almost identical to an Abbott and Costello routine. I believe it's Abbott and Costello. Oh yeah, check this out. So the top staple is detached from the cover, right? So that sort of reduces the value a little bit on this. So let's not put any more strain on it. Yeah, let's do it like this. That's better. That's the way I should have been holding it. Fascinating fun with numbers. Let's read these ones too. These one pagers are a kick. Fascinating fun with numbers. Huey, Dewey, and Louie's mind reading stunt. Look, ice cream cones. Yum yum. One would sure taste good now. And that's Uncle Scrooge. You can stop hinting, kids. I'm not buying cones. 10 cents an ice cream cone. If we tell you how much change you have in your pocket, will you buy us a cone? Whack. What are you, pocket spies? He swings his cane. He's so greedy. He's such a miser. No, we'll just read your mind. You couldn't do that in a million years. So go ahead. Okay, write down how much change you have. Double it and add 5. So he writes down 40. 40 times 2 is 80. 80 plus 5 is 85. Now multiply by 50, then subtract the number of days in the year. Multiply by 50. So 85 times 50 is 4,250 minus 365 is 3,885. There's the answer, and it doesn't mean a thing. Just so confident. He knows his math well though. He did 85 times 50 in one line multiplication. Oh, I guess he would. He's Uncle Scrooge. Oh, yes, it does. 3,885 plus 115 equals 40,000 and they add, or 4,000 and they added 2 decimal places, right? So 40 cents. Yeah, 40 cents enough. 40 cents enough for all of us to have cones. Bah, kids are too smart these days. Oh, look at him sweating. Use this same mathematics stunt to tell your friends their age and month of birth. Tell one to write down his age, double it and add 5. Multiply that by 50, then subtract the number of days in the year and add the number of his birth month. To the answer you add 115. The first two numbers will be his age. The last two, his birth month. Have fun. Cool. And there's tricks like this available online. Let's read this little pledge, this little plaque here. A pledge, Dell Comics to parents. A pledge to parents by Dell Comics, I guess. Hopefully you can read this. The Dell trademark is and always has been a positive guarantee that the comic magazine bearing it contains only clean and wholesome entertainment. The Dell code eliminates entirely rather than regulations. Objectionable material. Okay. So they're censoring their own stuff. That's why when your child buys a Dell comic, you can be sure it contains only good fun. Dell comics are good comics. Is our only credo and content goal. And this little disclaimer here, this was published in 1959, and this little disclaimer here is basically the witch hunts that went that were started in I believe in the mid 1950s with Seduction of the Innocents, the book that came out, and Congress got involved, and they were basically saying that comic books, and does this have the seal of approval? Comic books were polluting children's minds. And after, you know, Seduction of the Innocents, and basically comic book publishers were scared that Congress was going to pass laws to start censoring comic books. And there's different stories involved in this too, where some comic book publishers, specifically the ones who were producing superhero comic books, really pushed for this. But basically they came out with a little code, and we've seen the code, comic book code approved, and it's usually put on the top where it's, you know, supposed to be censored for content that at the time they deemed to be polluting kids' minds. And the stuff that they did were like censor words like vampire, horror, and stuff like this. And that was sort of the death knell for the comics. You know, as far as I'm concerned, some of the greatest comic books ever published. And as far as I'm concerned, probably the greatest comic book publisher of all time, which was EC Comics. The work that they produced was absolutely brilliant. And we've done some readings of EC Comics. But once the comic code came into effect, EC Comics went on. Well, they sort of stayed with Mad Magazine, so they kept on producing their humor comic books. But they stopped producing horror and science fiction comic books. And the horror and science fiction for EC was absolutely brilliant. Fascinating, fun with numbers. So here's another one of the same thing here, this type of story. And as far as this is concerned, I guess Dell was preemptively, you know, making sure that parents appreciated their G-rated comics. And here's, I guess, shorter story arc. Okay, let's go to the beginning and read through Donald in Magic Land. Right. Let's see what we got. Hopefully we'll get a chance to go through this whole thing, yeah? I think so. So, Uncle Scrooge. Donald in Magic Land. After deducting your 15-cent payment for this week, Donald, your balance still owing is only up to $14.73. Donald gasping. Up? If I keep paying on my loan, it's supposed to get less, Uncle Scrooge, not more. I borrowed only a measly 89 cents from you in the first place, but at 30% interest only. 30% interest computed on a monthly basis, compounded weekly. That's what Uncle Scrooge is talking about. And we talked about this compound interest in an ASMR math video where we talked about interest rates and how interest rates affect our society, right? And this is sort of an extreme version of what we talked about with differential accumulation, right? Wow, 30 cents, 30% interest compounded on a monthly basis, compounded weekly. It's simply a matter of mathematics, nephew. Unless you can raise your weekly payment, the balance has such a lovely way of growing. But it can't, can it? And this is something that payday loans, that's right. You borrow money from them, and this is a little bit more extreme, this interest rate. But wow, once you get stuck in that trap, there's almost no way out. Figures don't lie. You can see for yourself. Mumble, mumble. Look at Donald. He's got question marks. Uncle Scrooge is showing the mathematics. Yes, just as I thought. At your present rate of payment, you'll owe me $37.92 by your birthday. It's highway robbery. Sure what these numbers mean down here. 1051. Yeah, actually, that is the. I'm not sure what the 598. So this is Dell Comics number 1051, for sure, at the beginning of the 1051, right? But I'm not sure what the other number means. 598. Let's continue with our reading. You agreed to the terms, nephew. Now you're stuck with them. You have to watch your figures. That's Huey, Dewey, and Louie coming out. You have to watch your figures, Uncle Donald, whenever you do business. With Uncle Scrooge, remember, we said you should brush up on your mathematics. Mathematics, there's too much mathematics here already. On my budget, I need to be a magician. But I'm going to get out of Uncle Scrooge's clutches somehow. Just leave me alone, boys, to do some figuring. That's the spirit, Uncle Donald. Let's see now. If I can get half a dollar for my jackknife and maybe 2 bits for my rabbit's foot, and gee, it's going to take a lot of figuring. Uncle Donald, here's our book on mathematics. It might help you some. So they're bringing their textbook, I guess. Schoolwork. Well, maybe just to check up on the compound interest angle and a few of Uncle Scrooge's figures. Good luck. Huey, Dewey, and Louie are sleeping. 85 plus 9 times 6, carry the 5. 794. No, that's wrong too. Decimal point comes about here, I think. Oh, numbers, figures, nothing but trouble. I wish mathematics had never been invented. Lightning sound, I guess. Thunder. Not lightning sound, thunder sound preceding lightning. I heard your words, small one. Huh? What? Who? I am the spirit of mathematics, the torchbearer of progress since civilization began. Well, shake my tail and call me Shivers. Mathematics. The key to achievement, to all sciences, to the arts, to music. Oh, chuck it, Charlie. You're just talking about a lot of numbers, remember? You doubt the truth, Donald. Then you had better come with me. There's so much you should know. Come with you. You shall see. You shall see. It will be a great adventure. There you are, all ready for the trip. He put on his adventure hat. Wow, okay. Adventure is my dish, chum. But wait, if you want me to come with you, quit fading away. Where are you going? Slipping back into the fourth dimension of time. Do not fear. I'll be with you. I can take you anywhere. Oh, it slips through the portal. Just follow my voice. Follow, follow to magic land. I'm following my tail at least. It's the roots of the tree. Oh my gosh, what kind of a square roots, Donald. Of course, you know 5 is the square root of 25. Square root, roots. And 6 is the square root of 36. Okay, you don't have to tell me that stuff. I'm no dummy. And 2 is the square root of 4, and 4 is the square root of... Yeah, cats. The whole routine is strictly for squares. Perhaps you're more interested in pi then. Pi? Now you're talking. Trot it out. And flower, any flower will do. Tut tut in mathematics. Pi is the Greek letter used to designate the relation of the circumference of a circle to its diameter. Right. Trigonometry. Now we've done a whole bunch of trigonometry videos, right? Pi is very important. Circles, right? Triangles used to basically for us anyway to appreciate the power of cyclic functions, and that's what we've been creating in for the trigonometry playlist, right? Pi is 3.14519265, or to put it more briefly, just 3.3. You can't put it briefly enough for me, Bub. He's out of there. What do I care about the circumference or diameter of a circle? Boink. Runs into the number 8. See, that one wasn't even big enough. It's just like I said, the whole mathematics business is just a lot of trouble and nuisance. Donald, oh no, you are still so wrong. Oh, I knew it. His nibs, the spirit, is in again. If we judge it by the value received, mathematics is the queen of all sciences, yet the greatest servant of man. Talk, talk, Donald says. Perhaps the best way to convince you is to take you back to the world before mathematics. Well, at least Now maybe you're talking some adventure stuff. He's putting on his hat again. Ho, trouble, you mean. Here, look back to days before man could count and see the problem a quantity of anything represents. I give you my bear skin.
Mon goût.
You're supposed to gather me many sticks of wood for my fire. This is many enough. They're doing a trade. Your idea of many, not my idea of many. Oh, is that so? Give him you my idea of many in lumps. Oh, he's picking up the stick. They're gonna fight. Chums, wait. If you want my idea, why don't you? That's Donald, right? His clothes changed. He's got a club. His hat's changed. His clothes has changed. You keep out nosy. Already we got too many ideas of how much many is.
So they bang him over the head.
I guess one thing, violence was okay with the comic code, right? Smacking people on the top of the head. That's G-rated. See, Donald, there just had to be some definite way of measuring quantities. So inevitably, counting in numbers evolved. Oh, I wish they got with it before I got here. Ouch. With developing civilization came the need for some shorthand way of expressing numbers in visual terms. However, put down this much and this much. Figure out the language, right? The symbols of mathematics. I wonder what the guy's holding up, 5 and 3. I don't know what those are, what those numbers are. Our modern place value system, in which each digit's place in a number determines its value, is easy. Thousands, hundreds, tens, singles. 9,537. But writing numbers was not always so simple. Go ahead, give this early Egyptian a number to record. Oh, this is Donald now. He's got the gear of Egyptians, the clothes. Hey, Buster, let's see you put down 6,741. Wow. That's a long way to write 6,741. 6,700. Just be patient, feathered one. It will take a while, you understand. I guess that's the symbol for thousands. So that's the symbol, Egyptian symbol for thousands, and that one is for hundreds. Right, we got 6 of those. We got 7 of those, and then he's got to do 741. And I guess those are tens in Egyptian. Hopefully it's accurate. Yes, yes. Now four tens to make the 40. And then merely a single one. Oh, brother, it's a good thing I didn't ask him to write 6 million. He couldn't have done it in a day. Even centuries later, Romans were struggling with the same problem. Here we go, Donald. All roads lead to Rome nowadays. Rome. So Donald's clothes have changed again. And his own form, a uniform on. And I think that's sort of a take the concept, all roads lead to Rome, because Romans built some amazing roads that I believe they're still around now. That's how well constructed they were. Look, this Roman is writing your number. For a higher one, he would need a much bigger wall. He's doing the same thing. He's writing down 6,000. I'm sure why he only has D. Wow. I'm beginning to appreciate our little old 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9s. Donald. Later, the Romans added great range to their system by simply deciding that a line over a letter multiplied it by 1,000. Thus, oh wow, so 10 is the X. Let's show this. 10 is X, and a line over the X is 10,000. The L is 50, a line on top of the L is 50,000. Nowadays, with the mathematics symbols that we use, a line on top of a letter means not that letter. And we talked about this in for the real number set, right? Where Q is representing rational numbers, and Q with a line on top represents irrational numbers, meaning not rational, right? Interesting. Didn't know it came from there. Well, different interpretation of it anyway. We still use Roman numbers to number book chapters or a succession of kings. But think what a Roman schoolboy faced in arithmetic. Just multiply them, Donald. Today, you can do the same problem easily with our place value system. You said it, Spirit. It's easy as pie, even for me. 1,947 times 739. He's going about it. Our versatile digits were invented by an unknown Hindu, but we call them Arabic numbers, because Arabs introduced them to the European world in about the 9th century. Among the Arabs, there were many learned mathematicians in Baghdad, Damascus, even the Arabic universities of conquered Spain. They made great progress in an advanced form of mathematics they called algebra. I'm not sure how you pronounce that. Algebra, meaning to bind together. Ah, that's where the word algebra comes from. Algebra. That's cool. Don't you recognize it, Donald? Algebra. Donald's in shock. Oh no. Here's where I get off, Mr. Spirit of Mathematics. I'm willing to admit arithmetic comes in handy, but next, you'll be ringing in geometry and trigonometry and all those complicated flavors. Every branch of mathematics was developed to meet a need, Donald. Geometry, for instance, is from a Greek word meaning measurement of the earth, because that was the great need that produced it. This is for crops. Right, check it out. There's a house. Even long before the Greeks made geometry an exact science. The Egyptians developed knowledge of it to help reestablish property lines wiped out by frequent flooding of the River Nile. That's cool. They learned a lot about triangles, rectangles, and other shapes dealt with in geometry. I know the boundaries of my field can be sighted from these markers, and by extending the lines of this right angle, hold on, Roma, ho. There's the property boundaries, right? And one thing I should have mentioned about this this book, or about the animation, is that there were a lot of scientists, or there were some well-known scientists that were involved in creating this. So it gave a lot of credence to the animation and to the comic book, because it's sort of adaptation of the animation, where a lot of this information, I believe all of this information, or most of it at the time that we knew, is accurate. So let's continue with our property lines. Anybody can see your markers do not make a right angle. It does not meet the triangle test. I say it's a right angle. Let's check out what they do. I leave it to you, stranger. Should not a true right angle fit a triangle whose size measure 5 by 4 by 3? And that is accurate. That's one of the special triangles. 3, 4, 5. When it comes to this kind of mathematics chum, it's my day off. I'm just a tourist, you see. Look out, that marker. Oh, he's leaning on the marker. Pushing it over. It fell on the other guy's foot. Ow, oops, sorry. Oh, you clumsy oaf. Now you've moved it in Rama's favor. My favor, whose toe did it land on? But fellas. Scoundrel. Interloper. I didn't do it on purpose. I don't know a right triangle from a keppered herring. Donald, wait. He's like gone. They're throwing rocks at him. Zooms away. Zigzags. Smart way to go. Shh. Don't tell them where I am. Oh, there you are. He's hiding on top of the pyramid. At least you picked a fine spot to appreciate how well the Egyptians applied their knowledge of the triangle in the Great Pyramids. Triangles, fully, they come to a point in the most uncomfortable places. That's funny. Sitting on the top of the pyramid on the point, right? I just as soon as never see one again. Boom. Toot, Donald. You can't escape them. The triangle's versatile, dependable qualities are used throughout the world. Structurally, it is the perfect shape. Check out the triangles here. As long as the size of a triangle remains the same, it cannot change its shape as squares, rectangles, and other forms. Ah, that's a very good point. As long as the size of the triangle remains the same, it cannot change its shape as squares, rectangles, and other forms. That's right, all the sides are the same, but you change the angles, you can still keep the size the same. That's interesting. That's why triangles are a basic part of all heavy construction. From now on, just notice how often you see them, Donald. Say, that's right. And especially there are loads of them in those geo-something domes. Geodesic domes. Yes, you're so right, Donald. The framework of these structures consists exclusively of triangles, each exerting such equal weight and stress that no uprights are needed for support. Ah, that's cool. Right. Look at all the triangles everywhere. So that's one of the main reasons they use triangles in construction, one of the most stable. And we've talked a little bit about this, but I didn't know this part of it, right? As long as the sides of a triangle remain the same, it cannot change its shape as squares, rectangles, and other forms can. Proponents of a geodesic dome construction say there is theoretically no size limit. A dome a mile across would be possible. But how do they know if they never tried it? Silly. They just figure it out mathematically. There's a squirrel popping his head from a tree. Hole in a tree. So it's the spirit. Humph. Even from squirrels, I get it today. Squirrel's laughing. But it's true, Donald. All construction is figured out mathematically. That's how architects, engineers, and builders are sure of results before construction starts. That's how tunnel building crews know they will meet underneath a river. Look at this. They're building a tunnel underneath a river coming from one side to the other. As long as the mathematics done correctly. There's construction sites where bridges starting from one side to the other, they don't meet the same place, and same with tunnels and stuff, where they didn't do the mathematics properly. Yes, you will have to look hard to find a job where mathematics is not important. Scientists, sailors. It enables astronomers to measure our universe. Huh. I'd say that third star from the left is exactly 16 million trillion miles away. My, our figures agree precisely, Donald. Gee, that's swell, except for one thing, gents. I haven't the foggiest idea how I did it. Why? It's really quite simple, my boy. Here's the angle of our sighting 6 months ago when we were at this point in the Earth's orbit. And here's the angle of our sighting tonight. So with those known angles and with diameter of the Earth's orbit as the baseline, we construct this imaginary triangle to that star and easily determine the height of the triangle. That's cool. And they're figuring out the height of the triangle here with their angles, right? Man, these triangles sure keep busy. Indeed, they do. You know, trigonometry is a branch of mathematics dealing just with triangles and other shapes involving them. Although originally developed just to aid astronomers, trigonometry is a basic tool in countless fields of modern science and industry today. check this out. They got a computer there, right? And this was published in 1959 with a huge computer, a little scientist. Wow. Super cool. The designing and construction of supersonic planes. Yay! Whoosh. In optics, sonics, acoustics, and light. Eyeglasses, optics, light. In hundreds of military ways. Boom. Blowing them up. Ow. Spirit of mathematics. That's enough. Projectiles. Okay, so now I'm convinced about trigonometry. It sure is a very mathematical world, all right. Indeed it is, Donald. There are mathematics in every atom of our existence. All right, Mr. Spirit of Mathematics. You think you've got all the answers, but I'm tripping you up on one thing. It's what you said about mathematics and music. Just turn on your ears for a musical sample and tell me where the mathematics is in this. Donald is singing. Look at him go. From a jolly good fellow. From a jolly good fellow. Well, I don't quibble, Donald, if you want to call that music. But for the mathematics of it, we must go back to ancient Greece, to the time of Pythagoras. Humph, I still say music is in numbers. He's getting the Greek outfit, uniform. To Pythagoras it was, for it is recognized as the father of math. For he is recognized as the father of mathematics and music. Father of? We'll show you, Donald. First, he took a string. His little mouse here, pulling on his little string from his clothes, right? That's it. And now, with the string pulled tight, pluck it, Donald. Pluck. Boom. Music tune comes out. Good boy. Now hold the string exactly in the middle and pluck it again. Ah, hear that? It's the same musical tone, one octave higher. Now, divide the next section in half. That's it. Now pluck it again. Or pluck again. Pluck. Now, divide what's left and pluck again. Each time your note is one octave higher. Pluck. Donald, that was a great time. Well, what do you know? After discovering that the octave had a ratio of 2 to 1, Pythagoras used simple fractions to measure the lengths of additional strings. And eventually created Do, Re, Mi, Fa, Sol, La, Ti, Do. I guess that's the harp, right? Pluck, 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 pluck. You see, Donald? The fractions of Pythagoras created our whole musical scale, which is the basis of all Occidental music. Well, I'll be doggone. You find mathematics in the darnest places. music coming out of there. My gosh. Speaking of music, what the ding dong is that? Why, you're in luck, Donald. It must be. A meeting with Pythagoras and his followers. Their ideas were so advanced, they found it best to meet secretly. You cats, I don't blame them. I guess the music he doesn't like. Their gatherings usually dealt with serious and weighty subjects, but it sounds as if Pythagoras' musical skill is tonight's topic. Musical, oh brother. Thought combo was strictly from Squareland. Music, oh brother, that combo strictly from Squareland. Cute. Let yourself go, chum. Here, I'll give you something with a beat. Bringing the bongos, I guess, putting a beat to it. Boom, ti, ti, boom, ti, ti, boom, to bump, di, di, da, do, da, do, da, dick. Hit it, boys, it's mathematic. That's it, cats. Now you're with it. Boom de boom. Nice. Hey, you Dewey Louie are here. Yahoo for Pythagoreans. You're all reet, just so you give your stuff a beat. Hey, you Dewey Louie. You boys here too? Sure thing. Uncle Donald, why not? It's just logical. It was our mathematics books that you borrowed. Sure, logical. Here in Mathmagic Land, I won't be surprised at anything anymore. You speak with wisdom, young friend. I hereby proclaim you a fellow Pythagorean. Thanks, Pythag, old boy. You got a stamp. Congratulations, Donald. You have 1 year Pythagorean, the secret symbol of Pythagoras and his followers. It's just a 5-point star. And one thing about history, the Pythagoreans were persecuted during the time when they were coming out, because a lot of the establishment, the people who were doing controlling information, didn't like the new ideas, the changes that were coming. And I believe Pythagoras was forced to commit suicide, or it could be Galileo I'm thinking about. Oh, it's much more than that, Donald. Within the Pythagorean, Pythagoras discovered mathematical properties which influenced art and architecture from then on. Magical? The spirit is talking to them. The two shorter lines making up the length of the third line and the second and third lines making up the length of the fourth. Give them the properties, the proportions of their famous golden section. So check this out. Hidden within the Pythagorean is also the secret for creating from its golden triangle golden rectangle, which the Greeks admire for its beautiful proportions and its magic qualities. This particular rectangle is a most remarkable shape. It can mathematically reproduce itself over and over indefinitely, simply by swinging a short side to create a smaller brother. So you go, pshht. Or by swinging a long side to create a larger one, and still larger ones. Large or small, they always retain the same proportion. And what they're talking about here is the golden rectangle, right? And using the golden ratio. Fantastic. And we did, for math in real life, we put together a couple of videos about this when we're talking with Dirk, my friend, as an artist. And he showed us how he creates the golden rectangle, basically from the outside in, right? Starting off from the outside and spiraling in, creates the golden spiral, right? And I create the golden rectangle the way I've known how to create it, starting with the Fibonacci sequence and working from the inside out, right? So if you're interested to know a little bit more about this or see this work in motion, there's a couple of videos that we have out creating this and how my friend is incorporating the golden rectangle and golden ratio into his art. Fantastic work. To the Greeks, the golden rectangle represents a mathematical law of beauty. We find it in all their classical architecture. Well, I'll be doggone. There's a Parthenon, I believe. You're right, spirit. I can see oodles of golden rectangles in these old Greek buildings. And you can see them in Greek sculpture. For hundreds of years, the golden rectangle dominated the idea of beauty in the Western world, in architecture. Notre Dame in Paris. In the works of great painters. Mona Lisa. And even today, the golden rectangle is very much a part of our modern world. But the influence of mathematics persists not just in the creation of man. It is in nature too, where mathematical forms are limitless. In the symmetry of living growth, we see the magical proportions of the pentagram. Spirals, quadrants. Spirals, quadrants, hexagons. Say, looks like a giant sample of the honeycomb. You mean now we're in a beehive? Oh, look at the bee. Bzzz. Yo, no doubt about it, Uncle Donald. Running away. This fellow still requires some mathematical figuring, boys. According to present laws of aerodynamics, it is impossible for the bumblebee to fly. Tell him. And I don't know if this is true anymore, but according to physical calculations, the physics we understand, at some point, the reason or how bees are able to fly is unknown to us. We can't mimic it, or we can't understand it, But for startling examples of mathematical perfection, we have only to turn to a fluffy fall of winter snow. What now? Snow? Oh, the bee is small now. Microscopic enlargements of snowflakes reveal exquisite displays of perfectly matched angles. Infinite variety, never a duplication, yet each and every arrangement always adheres to a certain mathematical order. Every snowflake being different. Reminding us of the worlds of Pythagoras, reminding us of the worlds of Pythagoras, everything is arranged according to number and mathematical shape. Boy, oh boy, you said it, Spirit. Now this is my kind of mathematics.
Look at Donald, a little crazy with the beauty queen. What's that say?
Miss Cookie Week? Miss Cookie Week. Cute.
Look at you doing Louis, trying to stop him right there.
Uncle Donald, whoa, simmer down. I just want to study the subject more closely, boys. I'm really getting help to mathematics. You know, I've learned a lot here in Math Magic Land, even before you came along. I'm the one who really got the whole tour. The whole tour, Donald? Ho ho, we've hardly scratched the surface. But suffering cyclones, Mr. Spirit, how much more is there? We've done the numbers bit, algebra, geometry, trigonometry, the triangle, the golden rectangle. What about that important relative of the triangle who doesn't look at all like him? Relative? Huey, Dewey, and Louie ask. The circle. Nowhere in nature do we find a perfect circle, so it is a product of man. Try to visualize one if you can. A perfect circle. Okay, that's easy. Your part is sagging, Uncle Donald. Don't rush me. I'm working on it. There, that's fine. Now put a triangle in it.
Alright.
Just leave this to me, boys. I'll show you some real mathematical thinking. So they're visualizing it, right? Fine. Spin the triangle like a propeller and the circle like a weather vane. Just a sink. Now, what do you have? A ball. Yeah, it's a ball. Correct. The shape of a thing, the shape of all things, is first discovered in the mind. Now, just imagine yourself retracing the thoughts of some of history's greatest thinkers. That's for me. He puts on his graduation little hat. You ask yourself what you could do with a shape like a ball. Bounce it. Oh no. Try slicing off the top. and you have a lens. Say, not bad. That's cool. For reading glasses, binoculars, microscope, the thickness of a lens and its curves may be altered, but always to precise mathematical calculations. Optics. But take another slice of that ball, Donald, and you have a wheel, a very useful invention. Yep, a lot of possibilities in a gimmick like that. Look at the carriage. I don't know if that's from real history or not. Let's set aside the circle. Let's set aside the circle though, and now spin the triangle like a weather vane. The result? A cone. But with our mind, even now, let's slice the cone and we have gears. Well, what do you know? Slice the cone differently several times at any angle and we have, oh boy, satellite orbits. Right, all possible satellite orbits can be found in the cone. That's cool. This is in mathematics called conics, basically. Something that they used to teach in my part of the world in grade 12, but they removed it from the curriculum, unfortunately. And no matter how you slice it, it's always mathematics. But keep slicing, Donald. Right now, yours is the mind of all men. Look at Donald's face. Searching through the ages and finding the reflector, the spiral, the telescope, the spring, machinery, the piston, the cylinder, everything coming from a cone. From the triangle and the circle and your searching mind, Donald, you have created all things, all these wonders and more. But they were only the beginning, the proof that from certain basic form and principles, there are no limits to what the mind can conceive and create. Every new day, doors are swinging wide on new scientific achievements. Gas rockets. They're in a hallway with all these doors. Access to all this information, right? Cool visual. And doors that are locked today will be open tomorrow with the same key. Mathematics. That opens the doors, right? Oh, brother, what a workout. Puff, puff. Ho, ho. You've covered thousands of years in just a few minutes, Donald. But mathematics isn't all work. It's play. Play, too. It's the basis for most games. Games where you keep score or play on a geometrically shaped area, like baseball, football, basketball, checkers, chess. tennis, hockey, hopscotch, and billiards. Here is a game where actual arithmetic can be used on every play. These tables always remind me of how I wish our front lawn would look. In billiards, the playing area equals two squares. The cue ball must hit both of the other balls, contacting at least three cushions before it hits the final ball. This is specifically the game of billiards. Very, very few places you can play this now, right? Most of it is either 8-ball, 9-ball, right? Snooker. Only an expert can make several shots in succession, but these diamond markings on the rail are his mathematical guide. Yeah, cats, how did they help him? Yeah, cats, how did they help him? And there's always, if you look at any pool table, there's little diamonds that breaks. You can see them here, little markers. That breaks the pool table into segments, right? Let's learn about that. They contain a formula for making perfect shots. They contain a formula for making perfect shots, enabling the expert to figure out each shot in his mind before making the play. Now, there it goes, and it is hitting the cushions exactly as planned. So the person, that's the person's head, thinking about it in his mind, visualizing it, right? And then he does it. And then, hooray, he did it. Yeah. Wow. Click, click. Gee whiz, spirit. Gee whiz, spirit. The only trouble is, seem like mathematical games mostly call for fancy setups like billiard tables and chessboards and football fields. Not at all, Donald. Lots of the fun in mathematics calls for no more equipment than some knowledge of arithmetic. And perhaps a paper and pencil. Fun with arithmetic? Donald asks. Of course, fun with numbers is a fascinating pastime, especially if you know a few of their amazing tricks. Here's a trick. We can do it, Uncle Donald. Hey, where'd he go? Oops, we overdid it. They disappeared. Nimbo Numbo, the wizard of numbers. Brain teasing made easy. Amaze your friends. Wait, boys, this must be interesting. Goes on. Interesting indeed, Donald. With all of man's inventions, none can produce more intriguing results than simple mathematics. He's got a sign outside that says, your friends. Huey, Dewey, Louie, where? They've disappeared. Think of a number from 1 to 10, then add 8 and double the result. Okay. So you pick 16, add it 8, is 14. Double it, you get 28. All right, now divide that answer by 4 and then subtract half of your original number. 28 divided by 4 is 7. Let's see, half of 6 is 3. 3 from 7 is, he's confused. Ho ho, Don't tell me. I can look right into your mind and tell you the answer is four. Well, I'll be a ruffled duck, that's right. Oh, I didn't read your mind, Donald. It's a trick, of course. Show it to me, wizard, please. So I could catch my Uncle Scrooge flat-footed with some figures just once. The sign actually said, amaze your friends. Up here, right? It's not your friends, but amaze your friends. I will, but you must never scorn the magic of mathematics again. Never ignore the strength and understanding it can give you. I won't, I promise. This whole trip through Math Magic Land has been a terrific adventure, but if I could just learn something that would get me out of my Uncle Scrooge's clutches, oh boy, so be it. Ho ho. Oh, he's about to learn some math magic to free himself of his debt. I'll show you some tricks your Uncle Scrooge never heard of. He's been too busy to have fun with his figures. Say, these are all good ones, wizard. Ha ha, wait till you see this one. Mumble, mumble. You see, here's the idea. Mumble, mumble. Yahoo! This'll do it, wizard. With this one, I'll flabbergasp him. Wee! From now on, numbers are my dish. Bring on Uncle Scrooge. Uncle Donald, wake up. Uncle Donald, wake up. You've been dreaming. Boys, what are you doing in your night shirts? We want to strike while the iron is hot. Come on, let's get over to Uncle Scrooge's house. But Uncle Donald, what's got into him? Search me. Something sure got him steamed up. Uncle Scrooge, wake up. I want to settle my deal with you. Knock, 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 knock. What? You want to pay off your loan at this ridiculous hour? Humph. Well, I'm always ready to accept money. Where is it? Where? Have you ever heard the story of the ancient king and the grains of wheat on his chessboard? Of course not. I don't have time for silly stories. Fine. Here's my offer. The balance I still owe you is about $15 by now, I expect. So I'll give you my whole house to pay it off. Oh no, Uncle Donald, our house is worth more than that. Hope he knows what he's doing. Tut tut, boys. He'll have to pay me a little something extra to make up the difference naturally. Bah, I won't pay much. At least a few pennies, Uncle Scrooge. Here's your chessboard. I'll settle if you'll just put a penny on the first square and two pennies on the second square and four pennies on the third. Just double the number of pennies each time until you've given me some for every one of these 64 squares. Pennies? Oh no. He's flipped his lid. The house. That house of his is worth a few thousand at least. I could rent it back to him for a nice profit too. Look at Uncle Scrooge. this game, or this trick anyway. All right, it's a deal, Donald. Here, we've got it all down in black and white, and now we'll sign. Both copies. Oh, you're making a big mistake, Uncle Donald. There, all signed. Fine. And now, there's no use piling all the pennies on this chessboard. I'll just run up the total on my computer. $4,096 pennies on the 13th square. Gosh, it doubles pretty fast at that. Ha! 4,000 pennies is only $40. Just keep going, Uncle Scrooge. At least you have to give me as much as our deal calls for. Tish tush. Tish tush. If you're so impatient, Donald, my electronic brain will give us the total in a jiffy. Click, 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 click. His computer's processing, spitting out paper. Here it comes. All I owe you for your house is gulp. You, Dewey and Louie are freaking out. What? Oh no. Yep, that's the figure we agreed on, Uncle Scrooge. Look at the number. It's like huge. Oh my gosh. How many thousand trillion dollars? No, this can't be right. Electronic brains don't make mistakes. Wow. Uncle Scrooge's shoes just flew off his feet. Staple got detached as well during this reading. That's okay. The price was worth it. The price is worth it. There isn't that much money in all. There isn't that much money in all my money vaults. Not even this much in the whole world. Sigh. And to think you owe me all, you owe it all to me. Donald is happy. No, no. Give me your copy of our agreement, Donald. Please, let me out of it. I'll buy it from you. Make me a cut rate. You mean a nice round figure in even trillions? Tell you what I'll do, Unc. You just call things square on my loan and I'll tear up this whole deal. Oh yes, you don't owe me a thing, nephew. You're so sweet, so kind. He is kind. And all of a sudden, so smart. Uncle Donald, it isn't anywhere in our mathematics books. Where did you even learn that terrific doubling routine? How can you boys ask such silly questions? Why? I learned it back in Math Magic Land, of course. A magic land? Uncle Scrooge asks. There's no such thing. It's impossible. Oh, come on, Uncle Scrooge. Look, I'm all square with you. That sure ought to prove, eh? In mathematics, anything is possible. Walks away happy. It's the end of the story. We've read almost everything. The only one we haven't read is this one. So let's read this one as well. Right. That way we've gone from cover to cover for this reading. Fascinating fun with numbers. The secret of the wizard's trick. Pick a number from 1 to 10. Pick 6. Add 6 to your number and double the result. 6 plus 6 is 12. 12 times 2 is 24. Now divide your answer by 4. 24 divided by 4 is 6. Now subtract half of the original number you picked. 6 minus 3 is 3. Your answer is 3. By golly, you're right. Here's the secret. No matter what number is picked, the answer will always be half the amount of the number you tell them to add to the number they picked. If you tell them to add 3 to their number, the answer will be 1.5. If 4, the answer will be 2. Try it and see. Pick a number from 1 to 10. And it only works from the number from 1 to 10, eh? Cool. Nice little trick. That was a fun read, really. And we detached our comic book in this reading. Well worth it, well worth it. Well worth it. Very fun read. I think I might go and go online and watch the animation again. And there's little bits of it. I'm not sure if you can see this. There's little chips coming off. Right? And that's wear and tear for comic books. That's fun, that's fun. And if you do, if you're interested in math games, just reading off the last little bit, if you're interested in math games, you know, we did put together a video of sort of a grid game that one of my students showed me. And it's a really fun game where you create a square grid, 10 by 10, 100 squares, and you start with the number 1, you follow certain types of moves, and you try to complete, fill in the whole square from the number 1 to 100. And it's fun, and there's a video of us putting that puzzle together and actually trying one out, okay, if you're interested in math games, sort of pattern recognition games, okay? And that's Dal, 4 color number 1051. From 1951, right? Sort of an adaptation of Walt Disney's animation that came out in the same year, in June of 1959, right? I hope you enjoy it, and I'll see you guys in the next video. Bye for now.